Books on Tape presents In the Company of the Courtesan by Sarah Dunant, read by Stephen Hoye. A historical note. The history of Europe in the first half of the 16th century is one of political and religious upheaval. A corrupt Catholic Church centered in Rome found itself challenged by the emergence of Protestantism, which grew out of Martin Luther's rebellion of 1517 and spread rapidly through Germany and across northern Europe. Italy was still a set of city-states, vulnerable to attack from within and threatened from without by foreign invasion, most notably by France and Spain, the latter under the rule of Holy Roman Emperor Charles V. The most powerful Italian cities were Rome and Venice. With Florence in decline, the art and culture of the High Renaissance had moved to Rome, under the patronage of the popes. Meanwhile, Venice, situated on the mouth of the Adriatic, was still at the height of her success. A republic run by a large group of noble families, she enjoyed remarkable domestic political stability, a cosmopolitan population, control of the Western Mediterranean, and a dazzlingly rich economy built on foreign trade and commerce. Venice was a honeypot for merchants, travelers, and adventurers. The story you are about to read begins in Rome in 1527. Part 1. Chapter 1. Rome, 1527. My lady, Fiammetta Bianchini, was plucking her eyebrows and biting color into her lips when the unthinkable happened, and the Holy Roman Emperor's army blew a hole in the wall of God's eternal city, letting in a flood of half-starved, half-crazed troops bent on pillage and punishment. Italy was a living chessboard for the ambitions of half of Europe in those days. The threat of war was as regular as the harvest. Alliances made in winter were broken by spring, and there were places where women bore another child by a different invading father every other year. In the great and glorious city of Rome, we had grown soft, living under God's protection. But such was the instability of the times that even the holiest of fathers made unholy alliances, and a pope with Medici blood in his veins was always more prone to politics than to prayer. In the last few days before the horror struck, Rome still couldn't bring herself to believe that her destruction was nigh. Rumors crept like bad smells through the streets. The stonemasons shoring up the city walls told of a mighty army of Spaniards, their savagery honed on the barbarians of the New World, swelled with cohorts of German Lutherans, fueled on the juices of the nuns they had raped on their journey south. Yet when the Roman defense, led by the nobleman Renzo de' Ceri, marched through the town, touting for volunteers for the barricades, these same bloodthirsty giants became half-dead men, marching on their knees, their assholes close to the ground, to dispel all the rotting food and bad wine they had guzzled on the way. In this version, the enemy was so pathetic that even were the soldiers to find the strength to lift their guns, they had no artillery to help them, and with enough stalwart Romans on the battlements, we could drown them in our piss and mockery as they tried to scale their way upward. The joys of war always talk better than they play. Still, the prospect of a battle won by urine and bravura was enticing enough to attract a few adventurers with nothing to lose, including our stable boy who left the next afternoon. 2 days later, the army arrived at the gates, and my lady sent me to get him back. On the evening streets, our louche, loud city had closed up like a clam. Those with enough money had already bought their own private armies, leaving the rest to make do with locked doors and badly boarded windows. While my gate is small and bandied, I have always had a homing pigeon sense of direction, and for all its twists and turns, Rome has long been mapped inside my head. My lady entertained a client once, a merchant captain who mistook my deformity for a sign of God's special grace, and who promised me a fortune if I could find him a way to the Indies across the open sea. But I was born with a recurring nightmare of a great bird picking me up in its claws and dropping me into an empty ocean. And for that and other reasons, I have always been afraid of water. As the walls came into sight, I could see neither lookouts nor sentries. Until now, we had never had need of such things, our rambling fortifications being more for the delight of antiquarians than for generals. I clambered up by way of one of the side towers, my thighs thrumming from the deep tread of the steps, and stood for a moment catching my breath. Along the stone corridor of the battlement, two figures were slouched down against the wall. Above me, above them, I could make out a low wave of moaning, like the murmur of a congregation at litany in church. In that moment, my need to know became greater than my terror of finding out, and I hauled myself up over uneven and broken stones as best I could until I had a glimpse above the top. Below me, as far as the eye could see, a great plain of darkness stretched out, spiked by hundreds of flickering candles. The moaning rolled like a slow wind through the night, the sound of an army joined in prayer, or talking to itself in its sleep. Until then, I think even I had colluded in the myth of our invincibility. Now I knew how the Trojans must have felt as they looked down from their walls and saw the Greeks camped before them, the promise of revenge glinting off their polished shields in the moonlight. Fear spiked my gut as I scrambled back down onto the battlement, and in a fury I went to kick the sleeping sentries awake. Close to, their hoods became cowls, and I made out two young monks, barely old enough to tie their own tassels, their faces pasty and drawn. I drew myself to my full height and squared up to the first, pushing my face into his. He opened his eyes and yelled, thinking that the enemy had sent a fat-headed, smiling devil out of hell for him early. His panic roused his companion. I put my fingers to my lips and grinned again. This time they both squealed. I've had my fair share of pleasure from scaring clerics, but at that moment I wished that they had more courage to resist me. A hungry Lutheran would have had them split on his bayonet before they might say Dominus Vobiscum. They crossed themselves frantically, and when I questioned them, waved me on toward the gate at San Spirito, where they said the defense was stronger. The only strategy I have perfected in life is one to keep my belly full. But even I knew that San Spirito was where the city was at its most vulnerable, with Cardinal Armellini's vineyards reaching to the battlements and a farmhouse built up and into the very stones of the wall itself. Our army, such as it was when I found it, was huddled in clumps around the building. A couple of makeshift sentries tried to stop me, but I told them I was there to join the fight, and they laughed so hard they let me through, one of them aiding me along with a kick that missed my rear by a mile. In the camp, half the men were stupid with terror, the other half stupid with drink. I never did find the stable boy, but what I saw instead convinced me that a single breach here and Rome would open up as easily as a wife's legs to her handsome neighbor. Back home, I found my mistress awake in her bedroom, and I told her all I had seen. She listened carefully, as she always did. We talked for a while, and then, as the night folded around us, we fell silent, our minds slipping away from our present life, filled with the warmth of wealth and security, toward the horrors of a future that we could barely imagine. By the time the attack came at first light, we were already at work. I had roused the servants before dawn, and my lady had instructed them to lay the great table in the gold room, giving orders to the cook to slaughter the fattest of the pigs and start preparing a banquet the likes of which were usually reserved for cardinals or bankers. While there were mutterings of dissent, such was her authority, or possibly their desperation, that any plan seemed comforting at the moment, even one that appeared to make no sense. The house had already been stripped of its more ostentatious wealth. The great agate vases, the silver plates, the Majolica dishes, the gilded crystal Murano drinking glasses, and the best linens had all been stowed away 3 or 4 days before, wrapped first inside the embroidered silk hangings, then the heavy Flemish tapestries, and packed into two chests. The smaller one was so ornate with gilt and wood marquetry that it had to be covered again with burlap to save it from the damp. It had taken the cook, the stable boy, and both of the twins to drag the chests into the yard, where a great hole had been dug under the flagstones close to the servants' latrines. When they were buried and covered with a...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.